never forgets your place. To turn the page, just flip, flap, and click. The book page holder is not sold in stores, but available only through this limited-time exclusive TV offer for just $5.95. Here's how to order. Call 682-8496, 682-8496, or send your check or money order for $5.95 to Book Page Holder, 726 Richard Street, Vancouver, V6B3L2. Be sure to include your name, address, and postal code. This is a limited-time offer, so order now. That number again, 682-8496, 682-8496.
BCTV!
Good morning. When it comes to behaving like a bull in a china shop, Bill van der Zandt, the Minister of Education, takes the title without any argument whatsoever. But when it comes to behaving like a bulldog in the Social Credit Cabinet, I think the honor goes to Bob McClelland, the Minister of Labour. And this morning we're going to try and find out, on the eve of this anticipated forthcoming very shortly, any minute now, maybe tomorrow, the day after, spring, early summer election of social credit, we're going to try and see if we can get from Bob McClelland this morning if Labour is going to be the big issue. If Labour code changes are going to be the big issues. Now, also on this morning's program, very quietly and soberly, I trust, we're going to have a discussion on the very tragic case of the little Dawson boy. And for that purpose in the studio this morning is Phil Russell, who's president of the BC Association for the Mentally Retarded. And also with him this morning is Al Etmanski, the executive director of the same association, because I have a nagging feeling that Mr. Justice Lloyd McKenzie is, of course, correct in his legal decision, but there's something about this case which I'm sure worries every concerned parent in the province of British Columbia. For light relief at the end of the program, we have that fearless, self-described left-wing freak who has collected masses of newspaper clippings and produced an interesting little hysterical anti-social credit book called Bennett II. And that's my old buddy Stan Persky, who, believe it or not, teaches political science up in Terrace. As a matter of fact, they've been asking for him up in Terrace and wondering when he's going to come back home again. But first off the top this morning, Bob McClelland, the Minister of Labour. It's no exaggeration to say, Mr. McClelland, that segments of the labor movement are quite shattered by the fact that you have chosen arbitrarily to remove the representative of 60,000 workers from wingmen on the labor board, John Fryer and Jack Giroux. Why did you do that?
Well, Jack, I didn't remove them. Their term was up at the end of December, and we'll put two other people on, and they will represent the workers as well.
Two other people from the public service unions.
Well, I'm not so sure where. We move the wing members around to represent to various segments of the union population. I don't understand really how this got to be a news item, because their terms were up at the end of December.
And Fryer's never in town anyway, I don't suppose.
Mr. Fryer pretty well lives in Ottawa now, and we had a discussion with Mr. Fryer, and we'll just put two different members on. I don't think it's any big deal.
Are you asking organized labor for nominees to replace Giroux and Fryer on the
board?
Well,
we always ask for nominees, and I already have a bank of some nominees from which I will choose. We'll likely make some decisions on that this week.
This week. Do you not consider that the Labour Board has largely been in some ways infiltrated by NDP influence since the days of Davy Barrett and Paul Wyler?
I've never given it much thought.
Yes, you have.
No, I'd just be very careful to make sure that the balance is maintained between labor and management.
Well, you know as well as I do that all kinds of NDP-type lawyers and whatnot were on that board for years, and you wanted to get rid of them.
Well, I have a feeling that there may be too many lawyers around anyway on some of our boards, whether or not they're NDP or Socred or Conservative or who they are. I think we need, in some ways, to get back to having the true union representatives and the true management representatives on that board.
Get rid of some of the lawyers on the board.
I think some of them, yeah. I think we've had a tendency to have too many lawyers on those boards.
I happen to agree with you, but are there any of the employees, people who are planning to be dropped because their terms are up? Employer nominees.
There were three people whose terms were up at the end of December. I have one of them was Dan Bell, who was an employer's representative. I haven't replaced Mr. Bell yet. I may, however. But, you know, the primary reason we didn't reappoint Mr. Fryer was simply that he is spending all of his time in Ottawa.
Too bad. Next question. Are you going to make sufficiently major changes in the Labour Code when the session comes up, if one comes up, that Labour will be the issue in the forthcoming election?
Well, I can't answer that question. I have said that I intend to recommend changes to the government in a number of areas, and I've made those areas fairly clear.
Could you make them clear for me, too?
Well, the general area of democracy for in the workplace for so that the employees, the union members, have the right to make their own decisions about whether or not they belong to a union by vote, some ways of strengthening up the effects of illegal picketing on third parties. I think that when a third party or when anybody gets hurt by an illegal picket, there's an element of very strong unfairness there. And also, I'd like to see the opportunity for individuals, union members, or whoever to have access to the courts in a little more free way than they have at the present time.
In other words, to go beyond the labor board when necessary.
Well, for things like damages and that kind of thing.
Make it easier for employers to get damages on illegal strikes.
Or for union members to get damages when they're hurt either by an employer or by a union by a union.
Okay, make it easier for employers and employees to go to the courts for damages on patently illegal strikes.
That's correct.
You said decertification easier. In other words, if there's no breach of the labor code...
No, I didn't say decertification easier.
I thought you did.
No, I didn't. What I said was that the worker should have the right to vote. And the worker doesn't always have that right now, because it's up to the labor board whether or not the worker gets that right.
Are you talking about the famous shingle mill case in the Fraser Valley, where even though the members in the associated plant didn't want to be members of the union, the labor board said, you've got a union on the other side of it, you're all members?
No, that's a different case. The case that probably more appropriate to mention would be the Downey Street sawmill in Revelstoke.
And even our friend Monroe, I think, admitted publicly that on a vote he would lose that certification.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And you're going to define strikes a little broader. Definition of a strike.
No, I haven't said that, Jack. I think you're reading now from something that the Employers Council of British Columbia proposed.
I thought that would be your brief, the Employers Council suggestion to
no,
you.
No, I'll tell you, Jack, when I became Labour Minister, I asked everybody who had any interest in labour relations in this province to send me their input. I've never seen so much mail in my life. The Employers Council is one brief out of probably 100.
Tell you one thing, though.
And it got leaked. For some reason, I don't know why that one would be the one to get leaked, because there's all kinds of other ones around.
That haven't been leaked. One thing, though, is there's this curious situation whereby when a big union, like the BCGEU, is going into negotiations, first of all, they get a strike mandate from the membership. This is what we're going for. And then they don't have to go back for a vote on any issues. Would you change that so that there could not be a strike vote until the offer had been clearly delineated and put forward?
Well, I don't know whether that's going to be one of the areas we look at or not, Jack, but I think it's clear that a lot of people are concerned that strike votes get taken before any bargaining has been done, and I think that needs to be cleaned up a bit.
Okay, McClelland hints that the strike votes will not be allowed until at least some serious bargaining has been done and an offer made and put to the members.
I don't know about the offer part, but surely we must have some mechanism by which real bargaining can take place before the very serious action of a strike vote takes place.
Will you be presenting these amendments at a session before the election?
I don't know when the election is.
Are you prepared now if the House came to sit with the amendments to the Labour Code?
Well, I will be prepared, yes.
You will, at what time will you be prepared?
Well, we're working on it now, and you know, I have to make the recommendations to the government. But any changes that come, I expect to come in the spring session of the legislature.
Mr. McClelland, you do look bad in one thing. A year ago, the WCB and you announced that the compensation board was going to be an umbrella for farm workers, right?
No, I wasn't involved at that time, Jack.
Well, the compensation board said the board will cover farm workers.
Yes.
And that would have meant that it had been covered by WCB inspectors, WCB regulations, plus a levy, correct?
They would have been covered for both compensation coverage and for inspection and regulatory power.
Was it you who stepped in to stop that?
Well, no, I didn't step in to stop that. We've had discussions with the chairman of the Workers' Compensation Board and the BC Federation of Agriculture about many of the concerns that the agricultural community has, and I think we've come up with a very workable and sensible compromise. And don't forget that all farm workers will be covered by workers' compensation as of April 4th. There has been no change in that whatsoever.
When they are covered by workers' compensation, but they are not covered by WCB regulations or inspections?
No, not at this point. What's happening, Jack, and I must say that the Workers' Compensation Board had announced, its chairman had announced, that it would not impose any regulations for at least 1 year while the Workers' Compensation Board carried out a program of education. So all I've done is I've said, look, let's try something different in British Columbia. Let's put some of the responsibility right where it belongs, on the farmers themselves, and they are setting up a Farm Safety Council, which will be responsible for carrying out that education program over the next 12 months. And we want to see how it works. And if it works, it may be a great saving for BC employers, and it may be better than what we have in place right now.
Let me get this clear. WCB had announced with your approval that compensation itself would cover farm workers as of the 1st of April.
4th of April, that's correct.
4th of April. WCB had said, yes, we'll cover you for your injuries and claims, but no standards for the first year.
Well, the standards would not be imposed. Education program for the first year.
And you stepped in and you told the board, okay, instead of going that way, let's make it the farmer's responsibility for safety and education and safety.
That's correct.
And will the farm workers' unions be represented on this Farm Safety Commission of the BC Federation of Agriculture?
Well, I would sure hope so. The farm workers' union spokesman has at this point said that they wouldn't be involved, but I've insisted to the Federation of Agriculture that workers, farm workers, be involved in the Farm Safety Council, and it doesn't make any sense unless they are.
Mind you, you know, the average farmer isn't keen to spend large masses of money on bringing it up to the high standard of safety you expect in a plant.
Well, you know, they don't work in a plant necessarily, although in some areas they do, but I think that farmers have as much interest in making sure they have a safe workplace as anybody else, because now that they're covered, especially now that they're covered by compensation, because if they're not safe, their rates go up, and it will cost them more money.
I noticed it was only $3 a hundred, which seems to be a very low rate.
Well, that's the average rate that they got from what they're charging now for those. You see, there are some farmers who are voluntarily covered and have been for some time. So they took those farmers, took what they feel will be the experience, and averaged that down over the entire farm community. So that $3 is the actuarial average that they've arrived at.
Next, I've got to tackle you. I saw you almost flipping your lid the other day over in the legislature over this pesticide business. Let's have a bash at that after the break. Tis a fact, Mr. McClelland, is it not, that the jury said preventable homicide in the case of that pesticide death of a farm worker in the Fraser Valley? That was a strange verdict, wasn't it?
Well, Jack, you mentioned that I was a little angry when I first heard of this, and I was, and I apologize for that.
It seemed like you were accused of preventable homicide.
Well, that's the inference that came forward, and I think the decision by the jury is outrageous, frankly. I suppose I shouldn't say that as a cabinet minister, but it has really concerned me. They have misled the people of British Columbia, first of all, about the regulations that we do have for pesticides, which are the toughest in North America,
see,
next to California.
But I get the impression now that if you eat a piece of cauliflower, you're going to die of pesticide poisoning.
Well, everybody's got that impression, and, you know, we've got damn good pesticide regulations in this province. I left you some of the guidebooks that the farmers use in there. They're wanted all over the world, you know. And
we could put anything on paper, but it doesn't seem to work in practice.
But the point is that there wouldn't have been any regulation that anybody could have put in place anywhere in the world that would have stopped that death, and the jury should have said that.
Do we know how the man died? I shouldn't ask this question because I don't know the answer, but...
Well, you know, I think there's a very... I don't see how the jury could have come to any other conclusion. I've talked to people who spent every day at that inquest, and I've read all the press reports on it, and I don't see how anybody could have come to any other conclusion with the amount of pesticide that poor man had in his body other than the product was drunk. And
Consumed
in some way. And as I'm told that the man wasn't even a pesticide applicator, that he had no direct responsibility for pesticides. And I really feel distressed about the jury's report and the coroner herself calling homicide a neutral term. You've been around the police courts all
homicide
your life.
Homicide to
hardly,
me is murder.
That's right, and I feel the same way. In fact, I went home as soon as I did that interview, and some of the press people asked me how I could equate homicide with murder, and I looked it up in my dictionary, and that's exactly what it is. I think it's a distressing and outrageous decision.
A wrong use of words,
to say the least. Yes, to say the least, and I guess that's all I should say about
it. Okay, what happens now in pesticides? So do we have effective pesticide regulations which are effective in the fields?
Well,
and if they're not, who's to blame?
Well, I don't know whether there's anybody to blame, Jack. We have effective pesticide regulations which start with the federal government, who does the labeling, who does the testing, who does the regulations for disposal. Then it comes down to the Ministry of Environment in the province. We're responsible for everything else. We do all of the pesticide control on public land, which is about 95%, and then we put out guidelines on the private land for farmers. Some the highly toxic pesticides, applicators have to have a provincial license. The so-called run-of-the-mill ones, they don't. Maybe that needs to be beefed up a bit. But
the total impression was given that because you have... You stepped in and said WCB will not be covering safety standards, that you were to blame.
But anybody...
Had any relationship with them whatsoever?
Absolutely no relationship. Nothing could have been done that would have been different. And again, I think any right-thinking person would understand that just looking at the evidence.
If after a year of the Farm Safety Committee put up by the BC Fed of Agriculture it doesn't work, would you put it back under the compensation board?
I've told the... first of all, as far as pesticides go, Jack, I think they should always be where they are, under the Pesticides Control Branch of the Ministry of Environment. They have a good record, they do a good job, and they'll be working with the farmers and others to try and beef it up. However, now if you come down to the broad general safety question, if the farmers don't do their job, I've told them, and in no uncertain terms, that they'll be removed of that opportunity to take the responsibility themselves.
Take it away from them.
Take it away from them, sure.
All right, just one thing I want to get brutally clear. Fryer and Giroux, that terms had expired on
December 31st last year.
How much did they get paid for in that job?
Oh, I forget. It's a per diem. They get paid for what they work. It's $200 or $250 a day or something like that.
When they come and do a hearing. As a wingman, I believe you call it.
Yes.
Your questions to Bob McClelland, Minister of Labour and the Social Credit Government, after the break. Kind of dicey going for an election now, isn't it?
Isn't it always?
No, not always. Not when W.A.C. Bennett was here prior to the last one.
He had a couple of close ones.
Tell me, job creation. I don't believe almost what... I believe very little of what anybody tells me about job creation. And you're accused of failing to deliver on your promises.
No.
How many jobs have you created?
4,000 is with the programs that we've got for short-term job creation.
Oh, before I forget. Apprentices at BC Hydro. That dreadful decision whereby these guys coming up to the tickets were told, not only are you finished, we don't ever want you again. Isabel Kelly told me that you're close to a settlement to get these apprentices finished in the training at BC Hydro, except for one factor. What is the factor, Mr. McClelland?
Well, the factor is, Jack, incidentally, when you phoned me regarding this on a program several weeks ago, I told you that we could have that... those people back on the job, getting their apprenticeship training completed within the week. And we could have, but we have not come to agreement with the IBEW.
You mean the Hydro's okay?
Hydro's okay, the federal government is okay, the provincial government is okay, the union will not give us an agreement.
Why?
Well, it's something to do with their seniority clauses within their union contract, well, and they will not allow us. And incidentally, Jack, we've got 400 apprentices around the province on these pre-apprenticeship or simulated apprenticeship programs right now. Had no trouble with the unions. They're all union people.
Just with the IBEW.
This one instance.
The position being that the moment these guys get their tickets as journeymen, they are put back into the seniority and will dump other men in the union. Is that the problem?
Well, I guess so. I don't understand all the ramifications of it, but I just don't understand how it can work in other areas and it can't work here.
Could all of the BC Hydro apprentices conceivably get their journeyman tickets if the union cooperated?
Well, they could over a period of time. We couldn't do them all at once, but
we can
handle them all over a period of time.
Go ahead to Bob McClelland.
Yeah, I'm a little concerned regarding the proposed changes that we've been hearing about to the labor code. He says that he's a little worried, or he's worried about all the lawyers that have become involved in it over the past few years. It seems to me that we're going to be getting the courts more and more involved in wildcats and illegal or non-illegal work stoppages, and we're just going to go back to the old days of WAC. It sounds to me as if there's been no input from the BC Fed, more input from the BC Employers Council, and I don't think it's right at all.
Well, first of all, Jack, I've asked for comment from everybody, and frankly, the only comment I've had from official comment, at least from the BC Fed or any of the unions, is don't do anything, and I don't think that's realistic. Secondly, I don't. When I said I wanted access to the court, we will not be moving things like illegal strikes and those kinds of things into the court arena. They will stay with the BC Labor Relations
damages,
Board.
Damages, you said.
All I'm talking about is an opportunity for a person to seek damages for.
But Mr. McClellan, are you not giving automatic right to sue before, as soon as any picket action takes place, whether it's illegal or not?
No. No.
Okay.
No.
All right, then you've answered those questions. Still not to the way I like them, but okay.
Well, I've said no to you.
The other quick thing is I don't believe any employer, especially the farmers involved in this province, are going to do anything voluntarily. It hasn't worked in the past. And these guys don't give anything out of the goodness of their hearts. And
except
I don't
with one difference,
work.
They're going to have to pay for compensation.
Yeah, it's a little more than voluntarily in this case, because if they don't do their job, their rates go up, and it'll hit them right in the pocketbook.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Yes, sir. With reference to your remarks on regulating strike mandates, I put it to you that you do not have the right to interfere with the way in which a duly constituted democratic labor organization formulates its negotiating positions. This strikes me as a typical big brotherism, and I'd like further to refer you to the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, Article 2D, sir. Thank you.
Well, you know, obviously any government does have the right to set the ground rules under which labor relations are carried out in the province. We've done that with the Labor Code of British Columbia. It's not my intention to force any bargaining positions on either the employers or the employees. What I've said is that those positions should be at least established and some negotiating take place before a strike happens.
You know, there's a little nightmare recurs in my little pygmy brain from time to time in that somebody challenges closed shop hiring halls under Trudeau's Charter of Rights. Well, and that they are found to be discriminatory. Are you considering such a challenge?
No, I wouldn't do that. That would be a private matter if it ever happened. But there are certainly, I think, that some people have indicated publicly that's a possibility.
Because on the very face of it, a closed shop hiring hall denies a Canadian the right to do this and that.
To join a union. It denies a person the right to join a union in many ways. And
are you going to look at the legal implications of the fact that a closed shop itself might be a breach of the Canadian Charter of Rights?
We probably have 4,000 lawyers now looking at that all over Canada, and I think I'll leave it to them.
Because that would put everything in the fan.
Yes.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, good morning.
Yes.
I'd like to ask Bob McClelland a question. He was talking about taking strike votes too early, etc. How about Western Canada Steel, where there has been no meaningful negotiations have taken place in four or five meetings, and the company has locked out 250 employees, who approximately 15 are residents of Langley, who are Mr. the McClellan's constituents. And
they know about the Western Canada lockup.
Why in this day and age are we going to have 250 people locked out when it's we're being used as a political pawn as far as Cominco is concerned? Well, Cominco, they're trying to settle their contract up there for a 0-0 and 3-year contract and all this sort of nonsense and union bashing. I believe in fair play, as Mr. McClellan does, but certainly the workers at Western Canada Steel have been treated most unfairly by Cominco through their wholly owned subsidiary of Western Canada Steel.
Okay, hold your breath.
A company that has had untold public money from the public purse.
Hold on. This is a situation where the union came on, wanted 9% and 15%. Western Canada Steel offered 0 and 5. And the employers have locked them out, and there are no meaningful talks. Are you involved in that dispute through your mediation people?
Not at this point that I'm aware of, Jack. But we're available for these kinds of disputes at any time to put a mediator in. Our mediation officers have pretty good track records, and so if either side can ask for that, one of the things I don't ever want to do is to be a part of a government which interferes in the normal bargaining procedure. I think collective bargaining works, and it works best if everybody else stays out of the way.
Go ahead, please.
I think it's generally conceded by most people that communists and socialists, they just thrive on bureaucracy. It's become a disease, and I believe that the social credit were elected to get the government out of the people's affairs. And you don't seem to have done a very good job. You just seem to want to go along with it in a different way. I really don't understand that.
Okay, good question.
Well, I agree with the caller's philosophy. Perhaps we haven't done as good job as we should. We have committed ourselves to reducing the size of the public service. That is happening, and it will continue to happen. I want to get government out of the way as much as we can, too. I think people can probably do a better job on their own in many instances than government can.
Funny, mind you, you're down 5,000 in the civil service by attrition, and yet here you're scraping around for part-time jobs. You might have been as well to leave them on the payroll.
Who's scraping around for part-time
jobs? You are.
Jobs?
Your job creation program.
Oh, sure, but those are different kinds of people. Those are people, we're talking about retired people who are retiring from the public service. Our job creation projects and those that we cooperate with the federal government are meant for only one thing, and that's short-term jobs to get people over the hump until the economy improves.
More with Bob McClelland after the break. Yeah, there'll be a riot if the closed shop hiring halls beaten down by the Charter of Rights. Oh, just by the way, when do you expect the first wobble in Tumbler Ridge, Mr. McClelland?
I don't know whether there will be any further wobbles. I would hope that everybody will understand that there are some tough deadlines to meet in Tumbler Ridge, and they
are
should
be. Are
you
aware that the IWA, which is certified in mobile campsite construction, will be putting stuff up in Tumbler Ridge, and that they run across the arbitrary non-affiliation clauses of Ray Gauthier and the boys? That could cause trouble, couldn't it?
There's a possibility, I guess, but I would hope that sane heads will prevail. There are opportunities for that to be negotiated on a pretty calm way.
Because you can't stand delays in Tumbler Ridge this year, can you?
Well, it depends where the delays come. Certainly we can't stand delays in the production end of the thing. The town site can stand delays, but the others can't.
Go ahead from Castlegar.
Mr. McClelland, I'm interested in your concern for democracy here. Up here, we had a situation in which the production workers at the Trail Plant and in Kimberley never got an opportunity to vote on what union they wanted to represent them as a result of a really rather absurd, legalistic, and narrow decision of the Labor Board. And I'd like to know, does your concern for democracy extend that far, or are you just sort of basically interested in these people that want to get out of unions?
No, the problem of union rating is one that must have a democratic base to it as well. However, there have to be some ground rules set, and I intend to keep those ground rules in place, and I intend to make to keep the Labor Relations Board as the arbiter of those ground rules.
The company in that instance engaged in what was decided as an unfair labor practice throughout the entire period of so-called three-month period where they were supposed to be able to sign up a majority in the biggest industrial complex in British Columbia. Yeah.
Well, you know,
for some narrow legalistic reason, those people were denied a vote. Now,
well,
I'd like to know, what is your position on that? Are you saying that if somebody wants to get out of a union, fine, then they can get the democratic right to do so.
No,
but if they want to change a union, well, then they've got to abide by all these unrealistic and absurd rules.
Well, okay, your question's well put.
No,
you plan to intervene in the K.M.A.R. Steelworkers tussle?
No, the K.M.A.R. attempted to raid Cominco and lost. And they'll have another chance to do it again, and maybe they'd better do it in a little more. Yes, they will.
They did not lose. They were never accorded a right to a vote.
They didn't win. Put it this way. Can they tackle it again?
Sure. After the proper time period has expired, they can try again, and they better do a little better job if they want to win.
Go ahead, please.
Yes. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to ask Mr. McClelland if he has the, realizes that in fighting or disputing anything with the Workmen's Compensation Board, that you can't do it in person so much as far as an employer is concerned, and I wonder why that is, why they just take a letter writing rather personal.
Are you an employer?
Yes.
Do you say you're at a disadvantage dealing with the board because you can only deal with them by mail?
That's right.
Well,
didn't know that.
No, that's not true. If we have employers' representatives on the Workers' Compensation Board who are there to help employers, and I'd suggest that you call our office, the Ministry of Labor office, and in Burnaby, and ask for one of the employer's representatives. I've
gone through that, your employer's advisory.
Yes.
Phone Bill Hamilton.
I can't get through them. I'm now working through the ombudsman.
Well,
of course,
I don't know why you can't get through to them. They're there to help you, and if you're having trouble getting through to them, tell me about it, and I'll make sure you get through to them.
When are you going to replace Peter Cameron? Not Peter. Who was the deputy minister you lost?
Doug Cameron.
And you've got Isabel's carrying the full heat and burden of the day.
Well, I also have taken on contract a special advisor who's doing a lot of the deputy minister's work at the present time, who is Ian Stewart. And so Ian is helping me, and I'll be making a replacement for the deputy minister in due course.
It'll be Ian Stewart.
I don't think that's a foregone conclusion.
I just had to ask. What for the appointment of Ian Stewart as deputy minister?
I hope Ian's wife.
We'll give it a guy. I tell you, we'll give it a guy, and he'll get it confused and follow up. I shouldn't have said that. I normally ignore him, and I should do too. Go ahead, please.
Yes. Good morning. I have to agree with Mr. McClelland there in regards to the word homicide and that unfortunate death of that East Indian. I wonder what hand they would charge, the left hand or the right hand. And also, I have another point here. The BC Farm Workers Union are continually bringing up this unfortunate death of this baby girl that belonged to an East Indian woman that rolled off a table into a bucket of water while the woman was going out and getting water.
Must you bring it up again?
I'm sorry, but they continually bringing up and making this that we are the people of British Columbia are at fault for this. And in this other unfortunate incident where these three young East Indian children drown out in a slough in the Fraser Valley. It's also the fault of the people of British Columbia. The thing that irritates me more than anything, do not the parents of these children have any responsibility of looking after their kids?
Of course they do.
In fact, they should have been charged with criminal negligence.
Well, let's not get into that aspect, but are you going to have a good drive this year on the living conditions of these unfortunate farm workers in the fields?
Yes, Ministry of Municipal Affairs and other ministries are looking at that, and I hope we'll be able to improve those conditions. But don't forget, Jack, that Workers' Compensation Board regulations would not have helped most of the problems we've had, recently at least, with in the farm workers' community.
Go ahead to Bob McClelland.
Good morning, Mr. McClelland. I'm wanting to ask you a question regarding the apprenticeship training regulations in the province. I am a member of the Plumbers, Pipefitters, and Steamfitters Union of 170 here. And we certainly have a very fine training school now that is located on Rumble and Gilly, in Burnaby. Mm-hmm. Now, it seems we've been having a problem in being able to train our own apprentices, and that the province has not allowed us to carry on and have our journeymen train our apprentices in our school. Can you answer that, please?
I'm not aware of that problem. You better get to me personally, and I'll look into it for you.
Go ahead, please.
Hi, Mr. McClelland and Jack.
Yep.
All this union stuff, My husband's an apprentice for the BC Hydro.
Well, here we go again.
He's getting screwed up there. I work in the shake and shingle industry. I'm getting screwed up there. All these unions are going completely crazy, and they keep saying the employer's bad, the employer's a bad guy. You see this propaganda paper of the union, you know, to my husband they send it, and it says the employer's a bad guy, he's this, he's that. Why do unions hate employers so bad when the employer is giving all these guys jobs? These are the guys that are going out and sweating. These are the guys that get loans from banks, put their homes on the line to start a business, and the unions just hate them. Why?
You answer that.
Well, I don't know whether I can answer it, but it maybe that's it's a part of the symptom I've been talking about for a while, and there's too much confrontation tactics going on in labor management relations, and I don't know how we do it. I don't have any instant answers, but I'd like to see us get back to employers and employees talking to each other a little bit more, because they're supposed to both have the same goals.
Yeah, some of these things take months that should take days.
That's
to do.
Right.
Too many lawyers in there. Too many old NDP friends in there, aren't there, Bob?
I'm glad you said that about too many lawyers.
Too many old NDP
you know
friends in there.
Now when you get a simple hearing before the Labor Relations Board, the opportunity is great to have 10 lawyers in the same room on something that really is could be quite simple if it wasn't made complicated.
Charter of Rights gone crazy. Go ahead from Campbell River.
Good morning, Jack, and good morning, Mr. McClelland. I have a question for...
Well, let's have the question.
I have a question here for...
Bob McClelland.
I have a question for Bob here. I'm a logger, and we work with heavy equipment, as you know, and these steel spars that we operate are supposed to be inspected every 2 years for safety, and I've never seen one being inspected yet in the 30 years I've been logging.
Well, if you put it in writing to me, I'll tell Art Gibbons of the Workers' Compensation Board that he put it in writing to Bob. We'll do something about it.
One of the things that Gibbons is going to do, and because you can't inspect everything you're supposed to inspect all of the time with all over the workplace, Gibbons is attempting to develop a plan whereby they'll pick a target industry, the most dangerous industries, focus on them, get them up to snuff if they can, and then move on to another target industry. I think it's a good idea, and I hope it works for them.
When will we see you on the campaign trail?
I'm always on the campaign trail.
Sometimes you're more visible than others.
Yes, I guess that's right.
Anyway, what do you do for a living when you get beaten?
I don't intend to get beaten, but I guess I'll join you perhaps back in the ranks of broadcast journalism or something like that.
Easy money, no stress, no strain. My thanks to Bob McClelland. Next, we're going to have a quiet discussion with the two top guys from the BC Association for the Mentally Retarded on the dust case after the break.
We feel that the decision was unfair. We do not feel that he listened to all the evidence. We feel that we are right, and we wish that it had gone our way.
Are you going to appeal?
We have chosen not to appeal in Stephen's best interest under the circumstances. Any further delay could be...
There's been lots and lots of discussion, legal and informal, about the Stephen Dawson. And I don't think anyone can now argue with the decision taken by Mr. Justice Lloyd McKenzie when he said, it's not a question of a right to die. It's a question that this operation must take place. And the boy is apparently doing quite well after the operation. But many people, and I have with me here Philip Russell of the BC Association for the Mentally Retarded, who is the president, and Etmanski, the executive director of the same association, many people are still left with a vague feeling of worry. Is this not just one case of many in which a decision has been made on the degree of the child's illness? Well, does it mean any more than a decision in one case?
Very much so. We look at this case as perhaps even more significant than the Justin Clark case in Ontario. Justin Clark case was really an issue that was won on the basis of a decision for one individual.
Are you talking about the boy who wanted to lead his own life outside of the foster home and his parents didn't want him to? Is
outside of the institution.
Outside of the institution.
Exactly.
And his parents didn't want him to.
Right.
Right? And it was decided that he was capable of leading his own life outside with the proper support.
Indeed. And it's interesting to note that Justin Clark at age 4 was described very similarly to Stephen Dawson. And you can see what the capabilities that young man has today.
You see, just speaking as an ordinary person, And I interviewed the Dawsons before it went to Mr. Justice McKenzie. When somebody tells you, and I know this was changed, but you're left to this nagging feeling, the child has no brain, blind, is deaf, is helpless. You think, oh, God would do the child a favor by releasing it from its misery. And you wonder if an establishment is closing in to take away any reasonable decisions in the future for grossly defective children. Am I wrong?
Well, I think that you're reflecting on, in fact, what happened in the early days in the lower court hearing, Jack, where it became or appeared to be a situation where it was the Ministry of Human Resources on the one hand versus the parents on
especially
the other.
Especially kicking the door in, too. I'll never forget that.
Yeah, and I think in retrospect what happened is that we ignored the person, Stephen Dawson, who was not the vegetable that he was portrayed to be in the media. And I think in the higher court, in the Supreme Court, it became very, very clear that Stephen had many capabilities, did not seem to have the severity of the disabilities that were first described. For example, he was chosen among 50 children at Sunny Hill Hospital for a music therapy program. Clearly he was not deaf. There was good testimony and evidence that he had good light perception and was able to distinguish between light and shadow. So the total degree of his disabilities was certainly not what one would suggest as...
You see, this is the stuff which I tend to resist to believe. I'm wrong. Assure me I'm wrong,
you are.
Phil.
You are. In this case, clearly, when you look at the evidence of the people who deal with that youngster and have done so for over a year, the youngster clearly has potential. And again, I think in the appeal court ruling, it clearly showed the evidence that this youngster had potential. And unfortunately, for the Dawsons themselves, they did not experience this for whatever reason. And that's unfortunate. However, it's interesting to note their comments today are that they want to get to reevaluate Stephen in their life and what he means, and so on. Now, obviously, I think a bit more could have been done in communicating that kind of progress of the youngster to the parents.
You see, I'm not that I'm in any way casting aspersions on Sunnyhill, and I've seen the letters signed by all the nurses, and I've read both the decisions of Mr. Justice McKenzie and of Patsy Byrne. But is a parent not entitled to be kept fully informed at all times? And not feel that the medical profession is going to make every decision. Supposing I had, God forbid, a severely retarded child, am I entitled to make any medical decisions on that child?
Well, I think in the normal course of events, we all make decisions with respect to our children, be they handicapped or otherwise, in terms of medical intervention. If you're talking about the clear decision about the right to die issue, which this case was clearly not, then I think that's another matter. I think you want to have the very best information before you begin to make any such kind
of
decision.
Is there a case where there's a right to die for a super grossly retarded infant birth? Is there a case where there is ever, in your view, and I know this opens all these doors, and a right to die?
Well, I would make...
many, many children have hundreds and thousands, probably in my time in BC, or in Canada certainly, have been allowed to die.
Yes, and I think that's becoming less, though, Jack, as people become more aware of the technology that is available and the teaching strategies. But to go back to your initial question, I think we should make a distinction between a child or an adult who is terminally ill and somebody who is disabled, somebody who perhaps is chronically disabled.
In other words, if it's merely a question of artificial life supports, would you gentlemen agree on artificial life supports after the proper medical checking that you turn off the switch?
Jack, let's look at Barney Clark's case in Texas. Is anybody suggesting for a minute the plug be pulled on that?
That wasn't the question I asked.
It was. You're talking about heroic medical intervention. This clearly was not.
He's a medical guinea pig, Barney Clark, with the best will in the world.
Is that heroic medical intervention or is it not?
Oh, yes, with his knowledge and consent.
Yes.
With his knowledge and consent.
Yes.
Is there a right to turn off a switch at a certain stage on the what you might even call the clinical death of an individual on life supports? Would you say there is?
If you're talking about a youngster who can only survive
no.
with exhaustive medical intervention, and clearly, we haven't described that case.
No, but I'm asking you, is there a right to die at any time for somebody who's 98 years old in a wheelchair and totally should not be given heroic medical intervention?
If you're talking there about the case of the terminally ill personnel referred to it either, I would say that would be a matter of conscience for that person and the people surrounding them.
Conscience for the parent in that case, as well as the medical profession.
Mm-hmm. And others.
You see, I'm just trying to make it, I'm not trying to be awkward, I'm just trying to get it clear that on some occasions there is a right to die.
Jack, can I bring this up in terms of the Karen Ann Quinlan situation? Because this was drawn, the parallel was drawn many times during the Stephen Dawson's
She's
two court
alive.
Hearings.
Yeah, and I heard an interview with Mrs. Quinlan the other day, and Karen Ann is out of the life support systems. The extraordinary medical intervention is no longer there. But you know what Mrs. Quinlan answered to the question of what happens if your daughter is ill or when she gets pneumonia, mm-hmm. and she does? We treat her. We make her as healthy. We keep her as healthy as we possibly can, and we ensure to her comfort and her well-being. And clearly it was the same situation with Stephen Dawson in that he needed a very routine and straightforward medical procedure.
No, I'm going to take the position that Mr. Justice McKenzie made the right decision. That's obviously obvious now. There had to be one more or two more or 10 more shots at it. But surely I can take the position that there are occasions when there is a right to die.
Well, and we know, you know, Arthur Kirsten...
I mean, I'm not suggesting euthanasia. I'm not suggesting selection. I'm not suggesting committees. Certainly in an adult, there's a case when there's a right to die.
Yes, and Arthur Chrysler in Britain, the British author who decided to terminate his life two or three years or weeks ago, I mean, that's a clear decision. He's a mature man. He had gone through a well life, and he had made that decision.
Now, but on the very positive side of this case is you feel that this will protect the rights of the disabled individual, be it newborn baby or child, and properly so.
Well, exactly, Jack. And I think it's going to serve well all people who cannot communicate that decision-making process that you were talking about. And I think David Booker's put it very well when he said the court is the supreme parent in this situation and will help in that decision-making process.
Mm-hmm. It's a real tough one, huh? It's just this case, really.
Well, I think to some extent, Jack, we have to understand that the right to take life has to be argued and not assumed.
That's a good way to put it. The right to date life must be argued, not assumed. Your calls in the Dawson case, we just have one segment for it, but please contribute if you so wish after the break.
Mr. Bennett, I think the decision was outstanding. To my knowledge, it's the first clear judgment of a jurist, a Canadian jurist, that deals directly with the issue of equality rights. This particular judgment very forcefully says that persons who live with a handicap are entitled to the same kind of medical care that persons without a handicap are entitled to.
Two points I want to clear with you. One, I know I'm an old square. But all this discussion while the court hearings were going on upset me. That's point number one. Point number two, how come you got involved so directly, you two people?
Well, we got involved, number one, when we saw the article in the press on two Sundays ago. And secondly, we began to receive an increasing number of phone calls from parents of severely handicapped youngsters, much like Stephen, who said the case is not being factually reported. There's a lot here that needs to be looked at, and it's clearly not a right-to-die case. And that's when we decided to get involved in a more
formal
way.
What about all this discussion in between times and around it? Certainly led to a lot of confusion, didn't it?
Yes, I think issues like this are very complex, they're emotion-laden, and they need to be dealt with in
we're entitled to talk about it, but I'm just hesitant when the thing's in front of the court, everybody's putting in their two bits. Well, where am I going? Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Mr. Webster. How are you?
Carry on, please.
Yes, I have a question. All through the press, we've been hearing that the Dawson's son has been doing substantially better. What is substantially better?
Well, the pressure, as we understand it, has been relieved by the operation. He's now eating fairly well and is recovering as one might expect.
Yeah, because the pressure, the lack of the shunt work,
exactly,
must have been considerable.
Exactly.
Okay, anything else?
No, thank you.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Morning.
Jack?
Yes?
Yes, I thank God that the decision of the court on this case went the way it did. Because if it hadn't, if it went the other way, it would have placed in jeopardy the lives of many mentally retarded children across this country. And I think that would have been very tragic. I've heard very little comment on the fact that these cases, you know, what would...
Okay,
you've
made a point. Would this decision, had it gone the other way, have placed in jeopardy the lives of many severely or apparently severely retarded children in this country?
I think it would have placed in jeopardy many disabled people, Jack, because what was being used as part of the reason for decision was that vague, ambiguous phrase, quality of life. And that depends on yours and my interpretation. For you, it might be an extension of your contract here at BCTV. For me, it might be something else. But it's a very difficult term, and it's unfortunate, but those phrases... phrases have been used to describe other handicapped people, perhaps not with the severity of disabilities of Stephen.
Yeah, it would have opened the door to a little bit more, what do you call, push to end the life of those who are apparently totally retarded.
Well, Jack, in addition, just in that one facility at Children's alone, they do some 180 shunt operations a year, and that's just in one facility in this province. So those are the kind of people we're talking about.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yes.
I just wanted to ask the two gentlemen sitting there one question in the case of Stephen Dawson. If that Stephen could have stepped outside his body and looked at his situation that he was in at the time, I wonder what his decision would be. And right. I think it would be to have let him, myself, die or himself die.
Well, caller, I guess you're entitled to that opinion. It's interesting that the court saw fit in their best interest to choose on the right to live. And the second thing you should know is that you'd be surprised if you were in contact with many disabled people, the kind of energy, drive, and desire that they have to perform to the utmost of their capability. Again, it may not be what you particularly choose, but I can assure you that they are not that of the mind that they should be let die.
The country applauded Justin Clark and the decision of the judge to allow him to testify before the Ontario Supreme Court and to make a determination about where he would live.
Not a comparison, that one, though.
Well, it is a comparison, because what we're talking about is a six-year-old child in his developmental years, and one of the clear points that came forward last week was the fact that someday Stephen may be able to communicate in the same fashion as Justin Clark, which is using the Bliss Symbolics process. So we're really talking about somebody with potential.
I withdraw on that one. Sam and Arm, go ahead, please.
Good morning, Jack.
Morning.
The gentleman made two points here that kind of irritated me. One was the rate of the communication of life support. The child who could not communicate that he wanted his life extended or denied. And that the right to life should be argued, not assumed. Throw into this abortion. These are the doctors who will go and appear at a court like this and say this poor boy has to live, cannot die with dignity, and will zip off down to the hospital and perform abortions on children who could be born healthy.
I don't quite get a point, do you?
Pardon me?
Are you trying to bring this into the abortion issue?
Well, no, I'm just saying that it seems that in one case this child was born and now he's here in a really depressed state of functioning, and he's legislated that he has to live. You're either lucky enough to make it here, and then they're going to keep you. They're going to legislate you that you can't be allowed to die. It just seems that there's two ways to go.
I think that's she's comparing the abortion.
Yes.
The termination of fetus and this one here, but that's a little bit off the subject for us. Go ahead from Chilliwack.
Good morning.
At least it is for me.
Jack, I'm wondering what's happening in regards to the news media. Now, I have been personally very discouraged by the news media's handling up until at least the Supreme Court case. What recourse does a person have in a case such as the news media giving one side, the other side is presented simply in writing, but no coverage is given. So I have spoken with many people, for instance, who thought the child was still living at home. That's the impression that was conveyed in the news media, which the child hasn't been, I understand, for a number of years. The fact that the child is responsive and so on and so forth was almost totally ignored by the news media, so that people got the impression what you were dealing with here was kind of an extremist case of a child whose life, for instance, the news media used the word prolong. It was a life-saving technique, and I assure you there's a great difference between saying life-saving and life-prolonging. The impression was that despite the operation, the child was going to live minimally amount of time.
Well, I would think that on balance, the news media has corrected itself. I was one who interviewed the Dawsons themselves immediately after Miss Judge Patsy Byrne's decision. Then I left it alone until the judgment came down. But I think the media can be taken off the hook on this, because while there was a preponderance of the parent story to begin with, certainly there has been more recently a much bigger preponderance of the decision of Mr. Justice McKenzie and people like Etmanski and Russell. So I think it kind of balanced out. And people were well aware of the fact that the parents, according to Mr. Justice McKenzie, had hardly seen him. But that doesn't deny their right to have a terrific interest and a sincere concern, and the thought that if they wished, they would have preferred the child to die. They're free to think that.
Yes, Jack, our organization is a parent-based organization and therefore is inspired and motivated by the actions of parents. And what we would like to do and have done actually already is to offer the support of parents within the mental retardation movement in British Columbia to the Dawson family, should they wish it. And I gather that now they are reevaluating their position with regard to Stephen. And if we can help in any way, we certainly want to.
Well, that's good. Because I just have this one doubt that you people must be involved. Otherwise, we're left to, while I respect and admire the medical establishment, I wouldn't leave everything in the hands of the doctors.
Well, I think in this case, that was shown that, in fact, there wasn't sufficient input to the Dawsons to make a good decision.
Mm-hmm. Jack, you and I and others have a terrible responsibility now to ensure that Stephen and others like him get the programs and services that they need to live a happy life in the community.
Yeah, and Dawson second didn't carry it. My thanks to Phil Russell, BC Association Mentally Retarded, the president, and to Etmanski. Oh, by the way, did the government pay you a cost too?
No.
They didn't?
No.
Well, they were certainly bright of them at least to step in, and I trust they pay all of the legal costs of the Dawsons.
Can we make a comment on that, though? Our lawyer, David Bickers, is the father of a handicapped child and has donated his services to the BC Association time and time again in the past, and we did not discuss fee when we consulted with David to take this on.
Yeah, but the point being that I'm glad the government stepped in and took at least seemingly most of the burden of the legal fees off the Dawsons who are...
Well, I think MHR has been eminently fair in this case. I really do.
Except for kicking in the door. That's the only thing I won't give them credit for. That was lack of diplomacy and tact, to say the least. But that's beside the point. Thank you, gentlemen. I'm glad you were involved in this. And it is a landmark decision in that it means the state has its clear right through the courts to decide what the course of conduct will be under the laws of British Columbia, right?
Exactly.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Now we go from the sublime to the ridiculous. But he's committed. I've got to put him on. I've cancelled him out twice before. His name is Persky. He's an old buddy of mine. What's going on over there? After the break. For the majority of people in British Columbia, an NDP government is preferable to a Socred government at this time. This is the famous Persky, troublemaker extraordinaire, lecturer in political science in Terrace, BC, who has written a book based entirely on semi-accurate, reasonably accurate, and totally inaccurate newspaper clippings.
False. But go ahead. All you've said so far is false, but keep going.
I like the book.
I don't blame you. I like it too.
It's not worth $12.95.
$3.95. The hardcover is $12.95. There's very few hardcovers.
Does Persky come in hardcovers?
Seldom.
The decline and stumbling of the social credit government in British Columbia, 1979 to 1983.
Right. It's a sort of a, you know, kind of a little guide to the election to make sure you don't get mugged on the way to the polling booth.
Why would you, a far out lefty freak, back the NDP, who are the repository of the worst failures of the mixed capitalist-socialist movement and who have no guts at all? You know the NDP has no guts.
Well, the problem is that we don't have the NDP in to kick around. What you've got is a social credit government. And so when I look at both of them, I'm not unsympathetic to NDP in general, by the way, but when I look at the existing government, and then I'm actually faced with this choice about, well, which one do you pick? I mean, in other words, you're not going to vote for the Green Party or something like that. You're not going to vote for the Western Canada concept wearing those Alberta cowboy hats.
That's
so you got to pick realistically. And then I look at the present situation, especially the recession and how the recession is being handled. And then I say, well, given the actual choice, this is who I would pick. I'd pick the NDP, and here are my reasons for picking the NDP. This is what I think is wrong with social credit. That's why I spend a couple 300 pages saying
it. That's right, but given the NDP, you would just spend all your time trying to destroy them and replacing them with a government of your choice.
Well, I don't think that's very likely. What I'd like to do, though, is have a government that you can actually argue with sensibly. I think the NDP might be closer to that
kind of
government.
Well, they're better fun and power for the likes of thee and me. The NDP are far better fun.
I think so.
Sure they are. Now, I like BC Stadium. I think Bennett was just magnificent the way he took BC Place, imposed it on that lackluster, confused Pinko City Council of Vancouver, and put that stadium in there. That was a great move, wasn't it?
Well, if he wants to be the mayor of Vancouver, I guess it's a great move. By the way, actually, this is not a book that dumps on Bill Bennett totally. I have some good things to say about Bill Bennett, and you, by accident, Jack, have touched on one of them. I say that the building of that BC stadium, I think, is at least a popular success. I think most people approve it. And I also think that when you look at the finances of it, that it probably will end up not costing taxpayers a lot of money, like the Northeast Coal deal, say, is going to cost us a lot of money. I don't think the stadium will cost a lot of money. So that's one of the places where I say, I think Bennett is probably right, and he probably has popular support. And I also have a couple other places where I say that I think Bennett's done an okay job.
On what?
Well, I take the view, I realize this is probably contrary to a lot of other commentators, I thought Bennett did a pretty good job in his participation in the Canadian Constitution.
Good.
I thought amongst all of those crazed premiers that Bennett was probably the sanest and most moderate of them, and at least had some kind of understanding of what was going on. Maybe it was just good manners he acquired from his father.
Does Terrace College need another government grant?
Terrace College probably does need another government grant.
I don't want to hear what good Bennett's
done. Oh, you want to hear the bad stuff?
I want to hear the bad stuff.
Okay, the bad stuff we can get to.
Bad stuff.
Okay, here's real simple. First,
where's the kill button?
I won't say any dirty words. You know, it's very straightforward what I think is wrong with the Bennett government
right.
when you try to look at an imbalance.
Point
scandals.
One. Scandals.
Which tells you something about their character as a government. Number two.
Dirty tricks.
Well, dirty tricks is one of the scandals,
right.
Gerrymandering, all the rest of those things. I think
what, you mean
you
one mountain, one vote?
One mountain, one vote.
No, perfectly good report.
Certainly, if you wanted to have your grandmother be a riding, I suppose that'd be a good report. And I'm also referring all the way back to the Eckhart scandal, which still hasn't been solved. But that's only one thing. That just tells you that around Bennett are some slimy folks.
What about the fake letters to the editor?
What about the fake
yeah.
letters? Still unsolved.
Yeah.
Fiscal mismanagement, I guess, is one thing. And that's, I think, probably more important even than scandals. Because Bennett came into office saying that we're not going to have any deficits, we're not going to have any fiscal foul-ups in here, we've got some sound businessmen in there. So that's another area that I examine, and I think that Bennett has failed on a lot of the fiscal questions. And third and finally, response to the recession. What should a government do in the face of the kind of recession we've been having for the last year and a half? Especially, and I think what's so ironic about this is you've got a free enterprise government, a pro-capitalist government, shutting down everything it can shut down. If they really were free enterprise and pro-capitalist, wouldn't they be saying to us, well, gee, surely the capitalist market will recover, and while we're waiting for it to recover, why should we chop the economy into little bits? Why don't we try to make the recession as mild as possible?
Now, but that one thing they did with brilliant elan and insouciance was free brick from the stranglehold of government ownership.
Right. Brick is certainly one of the stories that one has to pay attention to. It's one of the ways that Bill Bennett got himself a few extra votes when he ran
for
office in 79.
What's wrong with $6 shares going to $2.95? That's free enterprise.
Didn't bother me a great deal. I gave my 5 shares away when I got them, as soon as I got them, hoping that somebody would make
brick
a few bucks off.
Brick in one word.
A laughing stock.
A laughing stock. Peer BC. Now that's great. The feds are going to.
Yes.
A laughing stock. Well, that's a pun.
Jack, this is Monday morning. You are awake. Right?
The Hindman affair. Now,
we passed Peer BC, the world's longest seagull landing strip, right? Yes, they're finally going to stick something on Peer BC. And I suppose if you own a hotel downtown, maybe you do. It's going to be a good thing for you. Or if you own a restaurant, if you're planning to sell some tortillas down there.
If I owned a hotel downtown, Bruce Erickson would close it tomorrow.
I don't blame him.
No, Peer BC, the feds are going to pay for it anyway.
Eventually, we ended up with a situation where we're going to get this convention center about 1986. The part that I spent a lot of time with is, how did they handle it? Wasn't it a disaster? I mean, they said we would build this nice little greenhouse for $25 million there to pay off the folks that run the hotels and the restaurants and maybe provide a few jobs in the course of that. And then pretty soon the $25 million became $50 million, the $50 million became $100 million, and soon it became obvious that they could not handle
it. Hold your breath. I'm going to help you this morning. Every social creditor in BC should buy this book because it exposes all the dirty tricks planned by the opposition. And they can take any version of this, turn it around the other way, and use it for social credit propaganda.
They can try. They'll have to go down to their local supermarket or drugstore to get a copy, though.
Stanley, did I have you on about your first book? Son of Socrates?
You've had me on about all of my books, practically, Jack. Every year or so,
I turn
out one.
Did you and I ever scream at each other in the 60s when you were the hippie leader at UBC?
We've screamed at each other in the 60s. We screamed at each other in the 70s. We're now working our way through the 80s, but you're threatening to retire on me.
Well.
I'll be stuck with all the screaming.
Stan Persky, Bennett II, everything you didn't want to know about Alan Garr, Marjorie Nichols, and all the other clippings you took out to write the book.
But it's not a
ask him questions. No, it's a good book. Actually, it's a very bright, informative book, and it's worth $3.95, but for God's sake, don't waste money on a hard copy after the break. Your calls. Seriously, there is some good readable research in this book. It's a kind of book I shall have around me when the election called and I'm interviewing succession of politicians of all kinds. But really, the NDP ain't in all that such a brilliant state these days. Who have they got to form a cabinet?
Well,
apart from Bill King and Davy Barrett, of course.
Yeah.
Who else is there that...
Well, they're certainly... actually, when you look at what's going
to
take place...
Do you think the caliber of the NDP backbenchers, potential cabinet ministers, is any better than the present caliber of the social credit ministers?
I'm not very enthused about reforming a cabinet out of people who've been sitting in the legislature for the last 15 years.
How many new members do they need to run the NDP this time? Is it going to be a real driving social democratic party? Half a dozen?
Well... The thing is, how many members do they have to get elected in order to form a government? And there, when you look at some of the candidates they've got, you'd say, not all bad. That is, it looks to me like they're going to take at least one of the seats, maybe both the seats in Vancouver Little Mountain. And there you'll get some, you'll get some potential candidates.
And if Vandersam checks out, they might...
Gene Swanson is a candidate in Vancouver Center. Is a credible...
She's a Cope candidate.
Credible person who's running...
She's way left of Davy Barrett.
Well, but that isn't going to frighten me.
Isn't it a shame that Williams didn't make it back into the party to give it the real flavor of democratic socialism?
Well, he could have run in some other riding if he wanted to. I think he was, and he's actually standing for a job with the on the board of the Vancouver Credit Union these days.
Oh, Van City Credit Union.
I saw him running. I was walking in the credit union the other day, and there he was out there campaigning, or his folks
Wouldn't
were campaigning.
Wouldn't talk to me during the last crisis he had. Go ahead, please. Hello there.
Yes.
Speak up to Persky.
Okay. I have a question for your guest, Jack. Mr. Persky, or Persky, or whatever his name is there, said that...
Everybody gives me a hard time.
...about his book, so-called, was that when Bennett went into office in 1979, he promised no deficit. And I find that a hard thing to say when he condones the NDP, a party, in my opinion, is a joke. What the NDP condones is deficit spending. They want to borrow more money. And that's the way they'd run the province in this time of hardship. And I don't know how he condones
okay.
the party.
Okay, how come deficit spending is bad for the social credit but good for the NDP?
It depends what you spend your deficits on. First of all, the Socreds condemned the NDP in 1975 during a recession for having a deficit. Right. The first couple of years the NDP was in office, they had balanced budgets just like the Socreds. They're fake balanced budgets, just like everybody's balanced budget is fake. But so in any case, there was a deficit. Bill Bennett made the most of it in order to get himself elected. And he said, of course, we're not going to have that kind of problem. Well, finally, he's faced with the Great Recession of the 1980s, and he has exactly the same kind of problem, and he had to back down on that. The question is, what do you do with the money you're borrowing? The NDP at least proposes, I don't think the NDP is going to go far enough to satisfy a person like myself, but they may go far enough to satisfy the average voter. At least they say they're going to spend the money that they borrow on creating some jobs. You've got 16% unemployment in this province at this moment. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do about it? Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that seems to me to be the major crisis.
Go ahead to Persky.
Yeah, Mr. Persky. Have you noticed that Dave Barrett's main issue on the campaign trail seems to be the ice cream bar that he's holding in his hand in front of the TV cameras while addressing his wife with the message that he still sticking to his diet? Now, I remember when Jack and Barrett both agreed to simultaneously go on a diet. Jack has lived up to his word, and demonstrated some of the leadership qualities that Dave Barrett can only wish he had. Jack, your midriff is very much smaller than it was this time last year.
You see that?
Webster for NDP leader, right?
Webster for Socred leader or Socred, Tory leader.
Tory leader. Come on, Jack, are you really a Tory? Are you a closet Socred?
Secretly,
I can't believe it.
I'm a leftist, weirdo, Marxist, Leninist freak, just like Persky.
See, there it
and
is.
And I've lost 10 pounds.
Jack's a man of all seasons.
That's right.
Okay,
Honey, Swaki, Mali, Bleeding Pulse. Victoria, go ahead, please.
Mr. Persky.
Sir.
Gordon Townsend speaking. I was the victim of one of Mr. Bennett's dirty tricks.
Right.
And no one has ever come to me for the story regarding that, about the principals involved and the person who, I believe, forged my name.
Right.
I'd like to get the opportunity one day to speak with you and possibly if you're going to be doing another book.
Hold a second. Who is Gordon Townsend?
Gordon Townsend is a person whose name was falsely signed to a letter that appeared in Victoria that damned an NDP cabinet minister. And then it turned out, after the letter was published, that Gordon Townsend hadn't signed it. It was one of the dirty trick letters that came from the Socred inner circle. This is the same man who's...
Yes, and the investigation is in the Attorney General's department.
It was never solved, right?
I have a very good reason to believe who committed the forgery, but I can't do anything about it at present, but I hope to be able to do in the future.
Would you please give your number to... Liz, hold on and we'll take your number off the air.
Thank you very much.
We'll give that to Mr. Persky and he may pursue it as he wishes.
I might even pursue it myself.
Don't hang up.
This is, on practically every one of the scandals, but I don't mean to drag up the scandals. I think this thing's more important.
Feel free.
But in any case, on practically every one of the scandals, none of them are solved. They all are unsolved.
None of them is solved.
None of them is solved. Not one of them is solved.
And you're a university teacher.
Are you going to teach? You're going to teach English?
You've got tenure?
You don't want to let Bill Vanderzam know that I made that mistake.
None of them is solved.
Not a single one of them.
You speak real good.
Not a single one of them is solved. I'm speaking as good as I can.
It's a bright little book. You can believe it or not, but there's some good stuff in it, and especially for social creditors to be armed against the Perskys who'll be hidden in every campaign audience with their nasty little questions. Stanley, I'll come and let you in class one day and let them know the facts of life.
Is that a promise?
Distinct from your
Is this a promise or a threat?
It's a threat.
Okay.
After the break.